Well, I'm taking the more. Playoff Letty, are you kidding me? Over 100 yards last time you saw these guys. It's the playoffs. Playoffs?
Playoffs.
What's going on, folks? Welcome into Monkey Knife Fights preview show for Monday Night Football. A little different this time. We're wrapping up Super Wild Card Weekend. Not just Wild Card Weekend anymore, Jim Coventry. It's Super Wild Card Weekend. How are you feeling today?
Doing very well. What a great weekend of football we had, and we ended up with Tom Brady.
Yeah, no, exactly. I mean, it's Tom Brady time. The man's 45 years old, still starting, still in the playoffs, postseason wizard. It's unbelievable. And I just, let me preface this show. I have one simple rule that's treated me very well. I don't bet against Tom Brady.
That's it.
I'm not saying that I'll put money on Tom Brady. I just have a, I don't bet against him. I won't do it. With that said, I really think this is a great spot for the Dallas Cowboys. Let's jump into this, Jim. We saw what happened in week one. Two very, very different teams.
Yes.
Obviously, Dak went down. Cooper Rush took over, and he didn't look great in that one, but then went on to win multiple games in a row, four games. So this is going to be very, very interesting from the Dak Prescott point of view. I think he has to throw the ball. Obviously, the run game, Tony Pollard has been banged up. So I think 255 and a half yards is extremely attainable for Dak Prescott in this matchup.
It certainly is attainable. The problem that Prescott's going to face here is the outside corners of the Buccaneers. Jamel Dean and Carlton Davis are among the better corners in the league. Dallas has their advantage in the slot with CeeDee Lamb. You're only going to get so much yardage out of the slot. Now, can they get yardage in the screen game to Pollard? Yes, they definitely can. I don't know how heavily they're going to emphasize that, but Michael Gallup hasn't played well this year. Noah Brown is a good blocker. But T.Y. Hilton, we'll talk about him later, he's actually given them a little bit of juice down the stretch. I think ultimately, you're right, there are paths to where Dak can go over. But I think those outside corners, remember, Tampa Bay's top seven against the pass. They don't have a great pressure rate. They're bottom four, so there's a little bit of an advantage for Prescott there. But the Bucs have really limited quarterbacks. They held Joe Burrow to 200, Patrick Mahomes to 249. It doesn't matter. Lamar Jackson at 238 back when he was healthy, but he's Lamar Jackson, doesn't throw a lot anyway. But this defense has not given up big passing totals because of those outside corners. So I am going to lean on the less with Dak Prescott.
Yeah, no, it totally makes sense. Obviously, throughout most of the year, you had guys like Akeem Hicks, big signings for the Buccaneers that were hurt. Now that he's back, they're getting more pressure on the quarterback, and they're getting after the signal caller of opposing teams. So I definitely like where your mind is at there, Jim Coventry. Now, Tom Brady, I just prefaced the whole show. I'm not betting against him. It's that simple. However, did you see what Leonard Fournette did in week one? And it's playoff time. Playoff Lenny's back, baby. Jim Coventry, it's time for playoff Lenny. Ripped off over 100 yards against these Dallas Cowboys in week one. So there is a formula. The problem was that was over 18 weeks ago. So, Jim, what happens? Does Tom Brady drop back, throw the ball, spread it out to Godwin and the Mike Evans of the world? Or do they hand it off to, quite literally, playoff Lenny?
Playoff Lenny. We love that, Connor. So, look, the offense of the Bucs has actually transformed in the last month. They, for most of the season, now I know Fournette had the big game in week one, but one of the biggest problems the Bucs had is their run blocking is terrible, and they were banging their heads into the wall by running the ball up the middle, second and long, third and long, and then Brady was put in a bad spot. What they've done in the last month is they've changed things up. So Brady, after very unsuccessfully having high yardage totals early, he's now gone over 280 yards in his last three full games, because there was a game he didn't play full snaps, and four of his last five. Week 18, he didn't play about a half, I think. But remember, that 281 he hit in his last three, he only hit that three times in his first 10 games. It was a completely different offense. Their pass protection is a top four unit, and they get center Ryan Jensen back, who missed the entire season with a knee injury. So he's going to shore up the internal pass protection. Now, Brady, we said he's airing it out. Yeah, he's thrown at least 43 attempts in 9 of his last 10 games. Dallas is just a middling pass defense. They had significant injuries earlier in the year. They lost Anthony Brown, a very good outside corner, season-ending injury. They lost their slot corner, Jordan Lewis, season-ending injury. Trevon Diggs is a boomer bust player. He is very good, but he has not graded out well this year. So he is not like a lockdown guy right now. Now, Dallas gets pressure. We know that. Number two in pressure rate. But lately, that pressure has been very inconsistent. And when he said earlier, we've got a top four pass protection line, I think Brady's going to have time to get it out. Now, remember, this Dallas defense gave up 355 yards to Gardner Minshew, 318 to Trevor Lawrence in about the last month, roughly. I think Brady's going over this number.
Yeah, I was leaning towards the over, obviously, because of my simple rule and because he put up 432 yards in his last actual start when he played a full game. Like he shredded the Panthers. And as you said, this Dallas defense is gettable through the air, and it's Tom Brady in the playoffs. That's really what it comes down to. And that's kind of why I'm leaning towards the more on the Dak Prescott side as well, because I think he's going to have to throw the ball, because I think this is going to be a fun game on Monday night. So that's, I'm just projecting a very high scoring game, and that helps the receivers. If we start breaking down Tom Brady's targets now, Chris Godwin coming in at 69.5 yards on Monkey Knife Fight. That is a prop that I like. Chris Godwin has been a monster in the last few weeks, absolutely dominating the line of scrimmage. And that's what I like his release. You know, a lot of people talk about route running. Chris Godwin gets open from the line, yes, and you can see it. 6 receptions last week, and not really a full game. But last, against the Panthers, 120 yards, 9 catches. Against the Cardinals, 8 catches, 63 yards. I think he gets 70 yards.
Yeah, he should sail over that number like you're saying, Connor. He should go over well. He's had at least 54 yards in his last 8 games. I know that's not the 70 threshold, but he's been productive like every week. He gets at least 8 targets a game over the last 3 months. I think the lowest was 7. He gets at least 6 receptions in every game since week 5. And so he is just the linchpin of that offense. I said earlier, Dallas is down their slot corner. They've been for a couple months, Jordan Lewis, and Dallas is just compromised in the secondary. And Dallas still, we said earlier, maybe that pass rush isn't as lethal as it was earlier in the season, but Brady knows it's there, and Brady doesn't want to deal with Micah Parsons. So what's the best way to mitigate that? You get the ball out quickly. As you said, who gets open instantly? It's Chris Godwin. Whether that's mostly from the slot, or if they decide the matchup is better on the outside, they could move him to the outside as well. In any case, I think this is a game where he sees 12 to 15 targets, and he has a really big game, Connor.
Yeah, no, I'm completely with you on that. And I'm glad that you actually see the way he releases from the line, because that, like, it's just sometimes it's the little things in football games that really are like, wow, that's impressive. And this guy is just explosive. Strong hamstrings. Very strong hamstrings. Mike Evans, very boomer bust the last little bit. What do I mean by that? Obviously, he took the week off. Panthers game, 207 yards. Cardinals game, only 3 catches for 29 yards the week before that. Boom or bust. It's playoff football. Tom Brady's going to have a couple deep shots. His deep guy, big target on the sidelines. If they're anywhere near the red zone, that's his guy. So I will take more on Mike Evans, but it's not nearly as comfortable as the Chris Godwin. Where I'm very comfortable in Chris Godwin, this is definitely more of a boom or bust spot. And I'm just taking the boom. As I said, I think it's going to be a high scoring game. And I'm taking the boom game script. So I will take more on Mike Evans.
Certainly hard to argue with that, Connor. And all it takes literally is one deep shot for them to go more. Now, I am going to go with the longer arching trend where Evans has not hit 60 yards in 6 of his last 8 games. The huge game he had against Carolina. Carolina was missing all of their cornerbacks, and they were pressing him. You don't press Mike Evans. It's kind of dumb to do that. One of the strongest receivers in the game. And he could get on top of you with the speed. So, yeah, he killed it there. So, realistically, It's been a rough year for Evans. Took advantage of a good situation. I do expect Dallas to do one thing. I think they will shadow Evans with Trevon Diggs. Diggs wouldn't have much of a chance against Godwin. The other outside receivers they're going to rotate in, or whether it be Julio, whether they move Russell Gage, Slaughter outside, they're not worried about them. So I do think Trevon Diggs goes on Evans. I think that does two things. Brady knows Diggs is a gambler, but he also knows, I said earlier, Dallas' potential with Micah Parsons in the pass rush is real. So I think if Brady's getting out quickly, and I think he doesn't want to take a risk of Diggs picking him off, I think the target share to Evans is less than it usually is. Brady's the guy who's going to see, what do I have? I'm not going to force it. I don't think he's going to force it to Evans in this game. So I like your more call, and I can completely see it coming in. Personally, I'm going less.
Yeah, no, as I said, it's a boomer bust, and I completely understand it. It's just, he's one of those guys where it's two big plays down the field.
One. You could do it with one, Connor. You could do it with one, man.
Hey, that's
yes.
It's attainable. It's not probable, but it is attainable. Yes. Now on the counterpart, Chris or CeeDee Lamb, pardon me. Wow. Three out of his last four games over 100 yards. Two of those games over 120 yards. I'm going to take the more on this one.
You have to, right? And I mentioned earlier in the show, you've got the outside corners for the Bucs. You got Jamel Dean, you got Carlton Davis. Well, CeeDee Lamb plays nearly 70% of the snaps in the slot. They get him a free release. They get him on the weaker corners. They are not Tampa Bay moving those corners inside. They are going to play their game. That's what they do. They can live with Lamb getting his damage in containing most everything else. You mentioned the 100-yard games. He's also had a great floor. He's got at least 50 yards at six of his last seven. Now, I know we need well over 77 yards here. Well, just over 77 to make the more. But that's going to work. Dallas against slot receivers. I mean, sorry, Tampa Bay against slot receivers. They give up 98 yards to Greg Dortch. They give up 75 yards to Rashid Shaheed. So, yeah, CeeDee Lamb is going to see targets here. He has at least 11 targets in four of his last nine, but not less than six. He's going to get double-digit targets. Yeah, he's going more here.
Yeah. I think this is a great night for CeeDee Lamb, and I think this is going to, as I said earlier, I think this is going to be a ton of fun. A ton of fun in Tampa Bay. Now, let's talk running backs, because I heard you mention you mentioned Tony Pollard out of the backfield earlier. I heard you say Ezekiel Elliott earlier. Tony Pollard, let's start with Tony Pollard. More of a receiving back, but he's had those breakout games this season. To me, I'm seeing a pass-heavy game script all the way. I think Pollard's going to be close. I have him coming in at 45 yards. So this is another one of those ones where I'm just going to stay away, but I wouldn't be surprised if he hit the more, but I will go for the less. Just a note, he is coming in. His projected fantasy point line is 14.5. Yeah, that I have more confidence in through his pass catching ability. And remember, Monkey Knife Fight is full PPR, 1 point for every reception.
So Connor, and I like what you're saying, the more on Tony Pollard for 14.5 points is definitely the way to go here. So this is playoff football, and game planning is hyper specific. It's win or go home. You don't have luxuries of being indecisive in your game plan. So we talked earlier at the beginning of the show, Bucks have Vita Vea on the inside, Akeem Hicks. They're tough to run inside on. Tony Pollard is their opportunity to get to the edge. Tampa Bay is not the same defense to the edge that they are up the middle. And Tony Pollard has had his carries scaled down. Now, he was dealing with injuries. It might be that. He's only seen 7 to 12 carries in four of his last five games. He had a while now. Zeke was hurt, and he was picking up the slack. But he only has 19 to 42 rushing yards in three of his last four, so it's been low. But I think for Dallas to win this game, they need to, A, get him on the edge. B, they need to use him in the screen game. They need to avoid that run defense. Pollard would be their best weapon for that. Whether he gets it on the runner through the air, I do see one or two explosive plays here. I think he's a great chance to score. We can talk about that later. But I do see him going more on the fantasy points. But on the rushing yards, that's going to be tricky, because if his big play comes on the ground, he gets more. The probability to me says he's less.
Yeah, I'm completely with you on that breakdown, Jim. Another beautiful job brought to you by Jim Coventry, ladies and gentlemen. His partner in crime, Ezekiel Elliott, and this is another less spot for me. Zeke, he hasn't looked great as of late, obviously. 10 yards against the Commanders, 37 yards against the Titans. And the problem is with the 37 yards against the Titans, it was on 19 attempts. So it's just he's more of a goal line guy now. That we can also talk about later. I love how we're teasing the touchdown dance.
Yes. But
you mentioned Akeem Hicks. You mentioned Vea. Devin White and Lavonte David in the second. Like, there's not going to be many holes to run this football. So I will be taking less on Ezekiel Elliott.
Yeah, Connor, I'm with you on the less here. Zeke is getting volume. He's had 15 to 19 carries in 8 of his last 9 games. So they're feeding him the rock. And, you know, he's great, like you said, near the goal. Last week, he didn't score. That broke a 9-game touchdown streak for him. But his rushing yards, weeks 13 through 17, you started indicating this, between 37 and 77 yards. That's not vintage Zeke Elliott. And the Bucs over the year, you know, if you're looking at numbers and fantasy stats, you're saying, well, they grade out as a below-average defense. But like you pointed out, Connor, Vea hasn't been healthy. He's healthier now. Hicks is getting probably, you know, earlier season he was hurt a bit. I think he's getting closer to form over the course. I think older guys a while to recover, you know. But I do think that they're in great shape here to slow down this rushing attack, force Dallas to the screen, throwing to CeeDee Lamb. So, yeah, now Dallas does have an advantage that they do get Tyler Biadasz back. He had a high ankle sprain in week 16. Dallas had to move linemen all around. That was a problem, because the communication of that line when you move different players to different spots is problematic. That'll help, but not enough to get Zeke to the more. He's going to be less on that rushing total.
Yeah, no, I'm completely with you on that one. And then just because we mentioned his name earlier, playoff Lenny, Leonard Fournette, 38 and a half yards. I think it's a Tom Brady passing script. However, playoff Lenny, baby. I mean, 38 and a half is just that is making me want to bite. Thank you, MKF, for making me just get kind of jittery and make me, well, I'm taking the more. Playoff Lenny, are you kidding me? Over 100 yards last time you saw these guys. It's the playoffs. Playoffs?
Playoffs. You know, realistically, Rashad White was a thing for a while, but he really hasn't been a thing lately. He's really backed off on the usage. We've seen Leonard Fournette go into more of the lead back role, with Rashad White being more of a backup. So my guess is Fournette's going to get in the area of 12 to 15 carries. Dallas's run defense is not good. Now they get Leighton Van Der Esch back. He did miss a couple games, and he's a good run defender, but Dallas is not good against the run. And Fournette with Ryan Jensen, the center back. And I think that's a detail that the books are missing here. That's going to be a big deal, having some of that interior blocking they haven't had. That's a huge upgrade for them. So I do think, like you, Connor, that Fournette is going to hit the more with relative ease. I see him going 55, 60-ish yards, maybe even a bit more.
Yeah, well, one thing I want to note is I have him down for about 16 carries tonight, just to kind of change the pace. I have him as a change the pace piece for the Buccaneers. And every time he's had 14 carries this season, his floor has been 44 yards. So,
winner.
Yeah, exactly. If projected game script, implied probability says he gets the more. So I do like Leonard Fournette to get his more tonight. Now, it is time for our favorite part of the show. I hate to speak for you, Jim, but I'll do it.
It's a
touchdown dance, baby. Let's get dancing. Break out the red dress, the shoes, the champagne. Let's go. Monday Night Football. And I will plug in the man I just talked about. I think if they're on the goal line, they're turning to playoff Lenny.
With you on that one for sure. What else do you like?
What else do I like? I like Mike Evans in the corner of the end zone. And because I have to add, it's CeeDee Lamb, because I think he can break some ankles on the inside, a little fake to the out, a little hitch and go, maybe a go route. I don't know. But CeeDee Lamb is going to find pay dirt tonight, because he has to keep these Dallas Cowboys to make them look like the favorites that they are. CeeDee Lamb needs to get his job done tonight.
You know, Connor, the one thing that we might hate about betting playoff football is that these obscure guys end up stealing the stage, right? We hate that. So I totally am going Fournette and CD Lamb, featured parts of the offense, Lenny in the red zone, of course. My third one, I'm going off the rails here.
Here we go.
T.Y. Hilton. There's going to be a double move, and he can still fly. We've seen Dak air it out to him. And with those great outside corners of the Bucs, Hilton can beat them with double moves. And I think that's going to be off a play action shot. I think it's going to come in the second quarter. I'm going to call my shot, but a point to the scoreboard a la Babe Ruth here. And we are going to say T.Y. Hilton is T.D. Hilton tonight.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not sure how much you know about hockey, but there was a guy named Owen Nolan back in the day playing for the San Jose Sharks, and he literally pointed at the – he got a breakaway, pointed at the top corner, let the goalie know where he was shooting it, and still buried it right there. So, Jim, if this happens tonight, I'll tweet that gif at you, and we'll have some fun. But just something I did want to note about T.Y. Hilton, he's been extremely productive, as you said, for against Tennessee, 50 yards – the week before, 52 yards, and then he had four targets against Washington. I don't really think they were playing a full-on game script in that. I hope they weren't. Otherwise,
I hope they weren't.
Mike McCarthy, man, holy smokes, you're in trouble. But yeah, I like it. I like it a lot. Let's get some game projections here from Mr. Coventry. Jim, what do you think is going to happen on a little super wild card Monday?
Now, I know that you think this game will shoot out, and it may well, very well may. But the history this year of these two offenses is, even when they have moved the ball, they've struggled to score points. Dallas had a while where they were running hot, but for the most part, they have kind of been ground down to a halt quite a bit against middling defenses at times, too. I think Tampa Bay pulls this one out, but I think it's 19-17. So taking the Bucs, they're getting 2.5 points, so I love that. Money line is a good play as well, but I am going to be the weirdo that goes under 45.5 on the Vegas point total.
Yeah, that is weird. 27-24 Bucs. I think Tom Brady gets it done at home. You know, I think when I was going through Twitter this week, and you know, we always like to try those, like find those little inside things to see where the players' heads are at, and Tom Brady tweets, "This is the healthiest we've ever been." That is just a scary thought. Tom Brady with confidence. Tom Brady is instilling confidence for a week with that Buccaneers team, a team of veterans, a team that's done it before. It's they got big time players, and it's time for them to play some big time football. And I think the Dallas Cowboys are sputtering right now into these playoffs. They are definitely the better team. However, simple rule, never bet against Tom Brady. Jim, let everybody know where they can find all your great content.
You can find me on Twitter at Jim Coventry NFL. I do a lot of threads. You can find me doing videos on YouTube, or RotoWire YouTube, I should say, obviously at rotowire.com. You also could catch me on SiriusXM Fantasy Sports Channel. This week, it'll be Tuesday from 8 to 10 Eastern, Saturday and Sunday from 1 to 3 Eastern. We'll do pregame shows for all the playoff action this weekend, so you won't want to miss that.
Yeah, definitely make sure you tune into that. Jim always has great breakdowns for all the players, and I love his projected game scripts, and those Twitter threads are fire. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us on this pre-show for Wild Card Monday Night Football. I'm Connor Rountree, that's Jim Coventry. Enjoy the game.